So let's see how the restart actually works. The restart is often described to have three phases. We will see later on that you can consider the first phase also to be optional, but let's stick to this first. The first phase is analysis phase, where we walk through our log to identify those transactions of type T1, so the winners, and those transactions of type T2, the losers. And now for the second phase, the redo phase, we do a complete replay of history. That means we replay our log entirely. We apply or we see if the changes written in these log entries are really executed already in our database. If not, we do this. And we do this also for the loser transactions, which is surprising a little bit. At first glance, I will say in a few minutes why we do this. So we walk through the file, we look at the individual entries, the log entries. We go and fetch the page from disk into a buffer. For efficiency reasons, of course, we do this also with a buffer here. Then we compare the log entry LSN with the page LSN of our page. And we identify, or we see if we have to apply the redo operation or not. And again, we do this for all transactions, also for the loser transactions. Then in the last phase, in the third phase, the undo phase, we remove changes made by loser transactions. And we do this, of course, in reverse order of the original execution. That means we go back the file from the back to the beginning. So again, I said this already in the previous video. How do we know that we have to apply a redo? Well, we're comparing the page LSN of the page we are just looking at to the log sequence number of the current log entry we are looking at. And if the log entry LSN is strictly larger than the page LSN, that means we did not incorporate the change which is described here in the log entry, then we are doing the information or the operation described in the redo part of the log entry. And in addition, that's important, we also update the page LSN to be now the LSN of the log entry. If we did not do this here, then the redo would not work if the redo is crashing, because there would be a risk, or it would be likely, that we are executing this operation described in redo multiple times. It's important to note that undo is always executed for losers, and you're not looking at these page LSNs when you're doing undo. So here's an example. Assume we have a transaction T1, which is modifying a page PA. Here we have in green circles marked the individual log entries, and here we have the log sequence numbers accordingly. Now here you see depicted by this arrow that we have written this page to disk. So it got replaced from the buffer, so we have written it to disk. So we have this page on disk, and we see here we have, together with this page, also the page LSN, which is 10, because this was the last operation that changed this page. Now for the forthcoming operations, we have here the log entries, but the page was not again written to disk. And then the crash happens. So obviously the last information that was included in this page PA on disk was the operation that is described by log sequence number 10. And those here are not yet reflected. How do we find this out? Well, let's do the redo phase. We know first of all that T1 is like a winner because it has committed before the crash. So let's do the redo. We walk from the beginning until the end of our log file. We look at this entry here, 10. We compare 10 to 10, and we see that this has already been reflected in this page PA that was present on disk after the crash. Then we compare 20 to 10, and we see that this was not yet reflected. So we're applying this operation and update this page PA, page log sequence number, to 20. For the simple example now, let's just do it on disk here. In principle, you would also, in general, you would also do this in your buffer only and not on disk. But let's keep it simple for this illustration. So you update it to 20, then you come here, you update it to 30, and so on, right? And in case it's crashing again, then you know already that you have already applied, let's say this is 30 and here you have 30, and you apply, comparing this 30 and 30, you see you have already incorporated the 30. Now, one more thing about the buffer, since I mentioned this now. So you're doing the same for performance reasons in the buffer. So you have your page PA in the buffer now, and initially it had, of course, the 10 as the page log sequence number, and then you would change it to 20, and then you would change it to 30. And yeah, well, if it's still only in the buffer and the system crashes during the redo phase, well, then we have still the same situation as we had it in the very beginning of this slide. But maybe in the meantime, you have updated this to 20, and then the crash happened, but you have evicted already before that this buffer page, and then of course you have this 20 also on the disk. Right? This is getting a bit more complicated to think of if you're assuming that you're doing also buffering during redo, but for performance reasons you would also do this. So now the question is, why do we do like a complete redo? So full history redo. That means we redo all actions also from the losers. Or we're checking at least if we have to redo them. Right? Don't confuse this if I say like sometimes we redo the winners. That means we of course do not redo them. We're just checking if they have been done, and if they not have been done, these actions, then we execute these actions as described by the redo entry. But of course we want to avoid that we are redoing. That means we're applying the operation multiple times, because the redo and the undo phase should also be idempotent. So we only want to have one operation done, and one operation done, and if you're redoing, we also only want to redo it once and not multiple times, right? So that's important to note. Okay, back to the topic of this slide here. So why do we do complete redo and not selective redo? Well, this depends on the configuration of our system. We consider here, as assumed earlier, that we have locks on individual records here inside a page. So it can happen that one transaction is modifying this one and another transaction is modifying this one here. If we have this situation, so within the page PA, two transactions can concurrently or dependently modify, then we have to do complete redo and cannot do selective redo. Selective redo only works if you're locking entire pages, so there cannot be concurrent modifications within a page. Why? So assume we have record locks, so we're allowing modifications within a page by different transactions, but of course to different records, but within the page it can happen, and we do selective redo. What's happening then? Here again, we have an illustration similar to the previous one. We have transaction one, which committed, so we call it the winner. And here we see we have an operation already executed. So this will be 10, the log sequence number, because here at this point we writing this page to disk. And here we have not yet reflected on disk, but we have the intent to execute these operations, and then the system crashes. So let's assume we do selective redo and we go through the file and only look at transaction one, because T2 is a winner. T2 is a loser. We don't want to redo losers now, right? Only the winners. So we come, we disregard this part here because it's a loser. So we come here and say, okay, 30 and 10, 30 is larger than 10. So we have to now apply the change described in this log entry and update the page LSN. And in the end, we're committing, so we update this to 40, and we're done for the redo. And now we do the undo, walking backwards in our log, and then we come to the loser entry here, and then, yeah, well, then what do? We compare 40 to 20. This would suggest, according to the aforementioned rationale, that this change that was supposed to be done here has already been done, if you're comparing 40 to 20. And then we're undoing it, but as you paid attention, This was never reflected in our page on disk, so we should not undo it. But how do we know that? How do we know that this page or this change pattern section 2 with LSN20 was not done in our page? We cannot tell this by comparing 40 to 20. Now, if we had done the complete redo, so in the redo step we also had applied the operation described here, then we can safely redo it because we know that we have also done the actions of the losers, so we can undo them now. That's the idea why we do complete redo in our setup.